Opinions expressed on this radio program do not necessarily reflect the views of this radio station.
My friends and I always tune into the Todd Levitt Law Show. Todd is entertaining, informative, and always delivers the goods.
Todd might not tell you what you want to hear, but he's going to tell you what you need to hear. And all you got to do is listen.
Hold on, Todd. Don't let go. It's time for the Todd L. Levitt Law Show.
This song is called Long Gone Day. Mr. Mark Lanigan.
Welcome to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show. Good morning, good evening, and good night. I'm yours truly, attorney Todd L. Levitt, broadcasting and podcasting in the middle of the mitten with my good friend Craig Russell, the muscle, the hustle, America's favorite nug. He is Mando. He is just dank. Craig Russell, the water's wet. The sky is blue. You have a vape pen in your hand. And we love you. How you doing, Craig?
I am fan-flippin-tastic. How are you, Todd?
As Craig Russell, the muscle, the hustle, says each and every week on the show, I am fan-flippin-tastic, Craig Russell, the muscle.
Good
not
to hear.
Bad, not bad for a day starting off with a little white truffle. Let me just leave it at that.
White truffle. Okay,
white
interesting.
White truffle.
Interesting.
Yes.
Would that happen to be the strain of the week?
It would not be the strain of the week.
Okay.
It's just what I started off today with.
Gotcha. Okay. I guess not every strain of the week is everything you start the day off with. I guess
it
that
is
makes
not.
Sense.
No. In fact, remember we were talking about Gorilla Butter last week?
Sure. Okay. I'll go with that.
What do you mean go with it? We had a conversation about Gorilla Glue, Gorilla Butter, and I was explaining to you that it was actually a flower or some sort of strain. And then so that's where white truffle, I think, comes from. It's sort of. Across, it comes from the genetics of Gorilla Butter, so I thought I would, you know, give a big shout out to White Truffle today.
Big shout out to White Truffle. Yeah, I learn something new on this show every week, it seems like.
Absolutely.
Every week. Every week. You know who used to say that? My late mother used to say that. You learn something new every day. She would have been 76 years old today, would have been her birthday. Happy heavenly birthday, Ma. Saying happy birthday to her.
Happy heavenly birthday to Miss Russell. She's a great lady, and I'm honored that I had an opportunity to get to meet and know her just a bit there, Craig. So, great lady.
Yes, fantastic lady. Gone too soon, but, you know, that's what happens in life. That's how things go. But there's another person we need to talk about who passed away, who I'd heard the name and didn't put one and one together that he was with the Screaming Trees, but Mark Lanigan passed away. That's who we opened up the show with today.
Yeah, Mark Lanigan.
Yeah,
I mean, in my opinion, I think Mark Lanigan is, you know, the first founder of grunge music with Screaming Trees. And a lot of people out there have never heard of Screaming Trees. Just go on YouTube and listen to Screaming Trees and read up about Mark Lanigan. The song we opened up with was Mad Season when Mark put a super group together with some members of Pearl Jam. Lane Staley from Alice in Chains. We've played Mad Season in the past, and
yep.
You know, Mark Lanigan, just an amazing human, artist, musician, songwriter, and definitely one of the founders, if not the founder, of grunge music before Pearl Jam, Alice in Chains, Soundgarden. And there's a lot of unknown groups that came out of Seattle, but Screaming Trees is just fantastic.
Well, you know, and I remember, this is going to show you how old I am. So working at the college radio station at CMU back in the late 80s, 91 Rock FM is what it was called. And I remember us playing the Screaming Trees, and this was probably 88 or 89. So this was, you know, at least two or three years before Soundgarden, Alice in Chains, and Pearl Jam, and Nirvana, and all those bands that came out of Seattle, you know, that really started the grunge thing. They were ahead of their time. And I saw that Mark Lanigan had died earlier this week, and I didn't make the connection that that's who he was in the Screaming Trees. So I'm glad we got to start the show.
Yeah, we're going to play. Yeah, I really wanted to open up the show with some Pantera, Cowboys from Hell. But to all you Pantera lovers out there, we'll destroy it next week with Cowboys from Hell. So
unless you think of a different, while you're driving up and down the ditch and you find a different song that you want to open the show with.
No, Pantera just destroys it in my noggin. So we're definitely going to destroy it with some Pantera. But Craig, we've got a huge show for the listeners.
Big show.
Well, we had a huge show last week with Trey Ayers. And,
yes.
Yeah, his specialty that is not only criminal defense but paranormal law. I mean, if there are aliens that come down from the skies, Trey Ayers will definitely be their attorney, that's for sure. But Craig, yeah, we're going to be talking today about, you know, stinky versus less stinky. I get questions all the time, and I'm not even a cannabis connoisseur or a bud tender, but people ask me all the time, hey, Todd, you're an attorney. You know, I'm a tenant. I have a landlord. Of course I'm an attorney.
Yeah.
But you know, I have these clients and individuals who listen to the show, and they call the office and say, listen, I have a landlord and I'm new to this cannabis stuff because I live in a recreational state or I have a medical marijuana card. And, you know, I don't want my landlord to find out that I'm smoking in the apartment or the house. And well, first off, I say, look, I'm not going to tell somebody to break their lease.
No.
The conditions and tenets of their lease.
No.
Because then I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to give them the right advice. But if somebody does call my office and say, look, it doesn't even mention it in the lease, Todd, that I can smoke or not smoke. So I'm thinking I can smoke. So they always ask me, not always, but a few times in the past, you know, what's the loudest? You know, what's the dankiest? What's the, you know, we're talking about the smell.
Right.
And some people refer to it as loud, the smell, the dank, the loud, the smell of dank. So we're going to be talking about some of the less stinky products out there versus the most stinky. And if you live in an apartment or you live in a rec state and you don't want to smoke your favorite flower or strain, whether it's cake mix or white truffle, whatever it is that you're smoking, we're going to name one after Little John here by the end of the year. I know that for sure. Exactly. So we're going to definitely be talking about that. Some dank, da dank, da dank, dank, dank.
Dank, dank, dank. Hey, you know, that show we did last week with Trey Ayers, I think really hit a nerve, because did you see our you know, of course, this is a radio show on 98.5 in central and northern Michigan, but also it's a podcast. It's downloaded all over the world. We had like an extra 1,000 downloads last week because of that show. He really must have hit some kind of a nerve with some people, because I think there's a lot more people who are into that. Then, you know, it's kind of like a, I don't want to say it's a secret club or something, but that's a, I think there's way more people into it than people realize. It's not super mainstream, but it's certainly more mainstream, I think, than people realize. That
but how many of us have just looked up into the galaxy, into the skies at night, and especially when you can see, you know, the Milky Way, and just think out loud or think to yourself, wow, are we alone? What is out there?
Yeah.
What am I looking at? Because how often do you take a moment and just look up and realize, wow, we're spinning. We're a rock. I mean, we are minute compared to really what's out there.
Yeah, so. and we talked about it last week. You know, how are we the only ones? You know, is it possible that this is a little tiny speck on some big giant's hand, and we're a solar system, and there's 10,000 other ones? How do we know we're the chosen ones who are the smartest ones?
Who did not want Will Robinson, the robot, and Dr. Smith to make it back to Earth? Come on, Craig. Craig, come on. Come on.
I really wish
Craig
they would have.
Craig Russell coming in at 23% this week, folks. Just 23%.
I wish they would have pushed that that smarmy Dr. Smith out the door and let him go, man. He was a jerk.
I wanted as a kid was Gilligan to get off the island and Will Robinson and a robot to make it back to planet Earth. Was that too much to ask
and
for a
you
kid
also,
going
and
the
you
70s?
Also and you wanted Ginger to walk through your door and close your door in your
bedroom. I'm in a doghouse since we've been talking about Ginger and Marianne, so we're not going to go.
Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, okay.
You could talk about one of the Smurfs. Maybe that's allowed. But hey, Craig.
Hey, Tom.
We're talking about Dank on the show this week.
Yes.
And I have a lot of shout-outs when we come back from break, but we're definitely going to be talking about now, some of the least stinky dank, stink, dank, same thing, smell.
Sure.
So it's kind of redundant,
sure.
But we're definitely going to be talking about the dank. And you are America's favorite nug here. And we are a law show of all shows, but.
You've been waiting to say that all week, haven't you? The dank, 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 dank. You've been waiting to do that.
You would have. Yeah, oh, absolutely. But that's why I wanted to play Pantera, Cowboys from Hell, Craig Russell on the Todd Levitt Law Show, but we're not going to do it this week, are we?
No. The Mark Lanigan passing away is overtakes the Pantera. But speaking of that, enjoy that, and we will be right back after a break on the Todd L. Levitt Law Show.
This song is called Long Gone Day. Mr. Mark Lanigan.
Welcome back to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show, broadcasting and podcasting in the Black Diamond Group mothership with my good friend, Craig Russell, the Muscle. How you doing, Craig? America's favorite nug, by the way, and also known as the Mando.
Which I still don't understand that one, but I'm, you don't know how I'm doing, Todd? I am dank to dank to dank to dank dank.
I had to do it.
That's how I am. Oh, my goodness. Hey, how was your week? How was your week in court this week? How's things going for Todd Levitt, attorney at law?
Well, most of the courts in the great state of Michigan, even though this show is heard all over planet Earth, most of the courts are still shut down.
Sure.
I had the opportunity to appear in Osceola County last week in Reed City, Michigan, which is located... Well, where would you describe Reed City for all the listeners?
Reed City is about an hour, maybe an hour and a half north of Grand Rapids, almost due north up 131.
Yeah. So not too far from Big Rapids, by the way.
Nope, about another 30 or 40 miles past Big Rapids. So
yeah, I got to appear in that court. Great court, Reed City Court. My good friend, great prosecutors, the Osceola County Prosecutor's Office, Anthony. I call him Tony. Tony does just a fantastic job for the citizens of Osceola County. Cameron, of course, Dion. I think Sandy also works there. But Tony, Cameron, Dion had the opportunity to hang out with the prosecutors and talk a little bit. I was in a full-blown suit, actually, because everything's on Zoom, so you're sort of half a suit throughout the last couple of years, Craig.
Sure.
You know how that is, right?
Yep.
So that's been the big running, joke. Not a joke, but the big running thing with people Zooming, half a suit up and then, whatever you're wearing on the bottom, and hopefully you're wearing something. But I got to appear in court, but because of the ice storm that just, ravaged the state of Michigan, at least northern central Michigan, I was wearing a new pair of yellowish orange Merrill hiking boots that I purchased for the spring, summer, and fall when I'm in the bush in the backcountry doing some hiking. And so I had a black suit on with a white shirt and a blue tie and these off-color hiking boots that match my Garmin watch. So, yeah, they were – Tony was and Cameron were a little bit fascinated by the color choice I had with the suit and the boots I wore to court. But, look, I'm not going to get out of my truck, slide on the ice, fall on my noggin and hurt myself and not be able to go into court. But everything went really well in Osceola. The magistrate does a good job. Judge Jaklovic, he's fantastic, and all the men and women that work there, and especially the deputies. And big shout-out to Mecosta County Sheriff's Department. I have a bunch of buddies of mine, friends that work for the county sheriff's department there in Mecosta County. So nothing but love for Mecosta County.
Awesome. And
that was a long shout out.
That was, man, you outdid yourself there. Now,
right.
What isn't it somebody's birthday? Isn't Jack, your godson, isn't his father's birthday this week? Was it not? Am I missing that?
No.
Am I getting that totally wrong?
Jack is my godson.
Right. I didn't know that.
AZ is my cousin.
Okay.
I love AZ. I love my family. Big shout out to my cousin AZ. I love everybody. Rosanna and dad and everyone. But Anthony just had a birthday, Jack's older brother, Anthony. So happy birthday, you know, AZ. He's also AZ Anthony. So
gotcha. Happy birthday to you.
So
probably not Uncle celebrating Tuna. His birthday like the
calls,
way you celebrate your
He calls
birthday.
Me Uncle Tuna.
So. Oh, that's cute.
Yeah.
That Uncle Tuna. Is cute.
Uncle Tuna and Craig Russell and all the listeners wish cousin Anthony happy birthday.
And a dank, 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 dank.
Dank to dank. Craig, let's yes. get to some show business here.
Let's get to some dankity dank, dank, danky dank, whatever. So,
yeah.
Let's talk about this. So, part of this comes from when you get people calling you wanting to know if they can partake in their apartment complex or in their rental house or something. I find it odd that there are still landlords that don't put those requirements in. The least, you know, most places well, it says right. it's a non-smoking unit or you can't smoke in this room or you can only smoke outside or stuff like that. But there are probably still some out there who don't have any requirements. And so talk about that.
Well, let me just back up a moment. When the laws in the state of Michigan and across the country started changing and a lot of the states went towards medical use, and individuals were obtaining, you know, medical marijuana cards and had a legal right, which they do now. And back then they did as well, to smoke cannabis in their apartments and then start growing when they had a legal right to grow. A lot of these landlords, it wasn't in the lease one way or another. And then
right.
things started changing. And landlords, and it was in really small print. And most people don't even read the fine print. Most people I find as an attorney, and think about it out there, listeners, how many of you sign a purchase agreement, you're closing on a house, and you're sitting there in front of somebody, and they're saying, sign here, sign there, notarize here, sign there, sign there. I mean, how much of that do you actually read?
Little. And, very little.
And then, yeah, exactly, very little. And very look, little. You always have a right and an opportunity to seek counsel, you know, someone that specializes in whatever it is that you have to sign. But when it comes to landlord-tenant agreements, you know, before the laws changed, landlords never put in their leases that you are not allowed to smoke cannabis or marijuana on the premise. So people started doing so. And people, listen to this stuff, Craig. It was like the Wild West. So when you had caregivers who started growing plants in these leaseholds, how they got caught was, the electric bills were just out of sight. The electric bills just shot up. You can imagine.
Okay. Sure.
Yeah. So that's how people got busted. The electric, I don't know who was turning them in, but the landlord would notice, hey, wait a minute. You know, this electric bill is extreme. And then what they would do is, because they can't just bust into the apartment according to the terms of the lease, they would contact the local code enforcer. Usually it was, you know, through the fire department. And they would say, hey, I'd like you to go in there and do an inspection. So now the tenant gets a knock on the door or a notice, because you should be given notice according to most leases, that the landlord intends on coming into your apartment or your house. And they would show up with the inspector, inspect the house. Sometimes they would have law enforcement with them, which they shouldn't, because an officer just can't walk into a house under the Fourth Amendment to illegal search and seizure. But they would be at the door and wait outside, which I think is still wrong. But back in the day, when it was Wild West,
you would have an inspector go in the house or, and with the landlord. And sometimes the tenants, most of the time, they weren't even home. They would find the grow, and they would, you know, kick the tenant out. And then sometimes they were prosecuted wrongfully. So it was like the Wild West back then. But as far as, you know, fast forward to 2022, in regards to the dank, if you have a legal right to do something, which in most states you do now, the question is, what is the least stinky, Craig? And so what do you think? I mean, you've been on this show with me for decades now, at least 25, 30 years.
Something like that.
If you were going to participate in THC, come on, give me one thing that you could participate in that has a, you know, a certain level of THC, CBD combination. How, and you're a tenant, and or you're outside, or you're, you have a legal right to be somewhere, and you're participating, and you don't want to, you know, smell the whole place up, which I love the smell of flowers, so.
Well, I mean, to be honest, if I was going to do something like that, I'd just do an edible. You know, that would make
there
it.
There you go. Yeah, that is one of the top. If that's one, if that's the top of the list, you do an edible. And by the way, folks, if you're a beginner, by no means should you ever just, you know.
Eat the whole thing. Don't do it.
Or any of it. You absolutely unequivocally should speak to a bud tender.
Sure.
Or somebody you know that's experienced in consuming edibles because, look, you know, you could be somebody that has been smoking for decades and you could, you know, have somebody hand you an edible, not quite sure knowing what's in it. It could knock you out. It could knock you off your feet right there.
Yeah.
Knock you out. So, yeah, edibles are interesting. They're, you know, a lot of people love them, but yeah, edible, you're right. There's a top one for you, edible.
I mean, especially if you are making your own edibles, then you know what you're putting into it. Then you have a better idea of how you're going to react to it. But still.
People react differently to something in a form of a brownie than they do if it's something that's rolled. Look, and I don't claim to be any type of cannabis connoisseur. Compared to what most people know, I know nothing. So I'm just having a conversation here, exercising my First Amendment rights. That's all.
And make sure, you know, if you are looking to get involved in this activity or you're looking to partake or whatever, talk to a bud tender, talk to somebody who knows more, maybe even talk to your doctor. Make sure you what you're doing is safe and good for you. Don't take our advice.
Go talk to my friends at Consano right
here. Yeah, there you go.
Michigan, downtown.
Exactly.
But look, you know, you said edibles, vape pens. There's another one, very popular, vape pens that contain, you know, a product with THC in it, vape pens. I mean, if you're concerned about your landlord or you're out in public and you don't want, you know, to smoke it or take a hit and cause a lot of smoke, which is going to cause some dank, then you might want to, you know, try a vape pen. There's a lot of great stores around the country and the world that are now, you know, selling vape pens. But again, talk to somebody who has used a vape pen. Go to a store. Talk to someone that is knowledgeable. Don't listen to anything we're telling you.
Yeah.
We're just having a conversation here.
Yeah, make sure, because we don't know. We know, but we
don't
know.
What do you think is the most stinky, Craig? So if you're a tenant and you have a landlord, and look, I'm not telling anybody to do this unless you have a legal right to do so in your landlord-tenant agreement, in the actual agreement itself, but a lot of people, look, you know how people are. So what do you think is going to cause the most smoke, the most dank, the most smell, the loudest noise? What is it, Craig?
Probably using like a bong or something like that, wouldn't it?
Yeah, absolutely, a bong.
A bong?
Yeah, absolutely, a bong.
Yeah.
My first choice was just a blunt. So, which, you know, but a bong, absolutely a bong, depending upon the strain, the flower. I mean, I've seen some bongs that have like 7-8 tentacles coming out of them.
Yep.
There are some really great products out there right now.
Yep. Also, you know, probably pipes and probably, you know, cigarette joints are probably another thing that would cause a lot more smoke and a lot more smell. You know, bongs, those kind of, I mean, they all kind of are in the same category, but, you know, but
yeah, pipes for sure. We were at Sour Apple the other day. They have a location in Everett, Michigan, which, by the way, right near Reed City, Osceola County. Another big shout out to my buddy Tony in Osceola County there. I'm really overdoing it here with Osceola County, but it's a great county. Right. What do you want from it?
That's all right.
But Sour Apple, that's a great store, Mount Pleasant, Everett. great smoke shop, and they sell all kinds of great products, but pipes included. But yeah, pipes definitely, I think they're more stinky than not, in my opinion, than less stinky if you have a pipe around.
Gotcha.
So I would go bongs, pipes, and then I would go joints after that as far as, you know, more stinky.
Gotcha. We do have to take a break in the Todd I Love It Law show, but this topic has
nothing to do with law. Nothing.
Well, but you know what, though?
I tried to tie in a landlord-tenant issue there.
But I was going to say, I actually got a question about this in the law. You talking about this has got my wheels going. So I will ask my question.
You say weeds going or wheels?
I said wheels. Wheels are going. I'll ask my question when we come back from this break.
This song is called Long Gone Day. Mr. Mark Lanigan.
Welcome back to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show, honoring the life of one Mark Lanigan from the Screaming Trees, along with Mad Season, Lane Staley, and the Supergroup, bringing it back with those guys. Just a tragedy. 57, that's way too young. Way too young. That's about as old as you are, isn't it, Todd?
I will be 57 here in just a minute.
See, I'm not trying to say anything, but I'm glad you take good care of yourself, riding your fat bike and keeping up with the trends and things and keeping yourself healthy. So that's good, because we don't want to see anything happen to you at 57. Come on.
You know, you can be healthy and you could be out there in the woods. You know, I know a lot of people who are very healthy, but they'll fall, and I'm not happy this happened, they'll fall out of a deer blind As I always talk about, you know, you could be out in the woods, and if the wind is blowing hard, we call them widowmakers. You got to watch out for branches falling, trees falling over, because they do fall. And if you spend a lot of time in the woods, as I do and a lot of our listeners do, it can be dangerous out there. You got to be careful where you walk. You could be really deep out there, and if you don't walk properly or have the right, shoes or boots, you're going to sprain your ankle. So you got to be really careful out there.
And on top of it, some of these things, life just happens. It doesn't matter how healthy you are or if you're not healthy or whatever. Sometimes falling, a branch, being out in the woods, sometimes these things just happen because that's just how life works. There was a story of the guy, I think it was in the UP, who fell off the ice shelf on Lake Superior, and they still haven't found him yet. I mean, that's just tragic. So you got to just be careful with some of that kind of stuff. But
absolutely. So, Craig, we're trying to tie in, the least stinky, quiet, versus the loudest, the most stinky,
yes,
when it comes to different forms of enjoying marijuana here today. And we're tying it in with landlords.
Yeah.
And so, again, just to sum it up, a landlord, when you sign an agreement to lease a certain leasehold, it's a contract.
Yep.
And there are certain terms and conditions. There are certain things that you are required to do as a tenant, and there's certain things a landlord is required to do. I've seen a lot of cases over the decades, and I don't practice landlord-tenant law. I don't want anybody calling me. I'm a criminal defense lawyer, please. But I am in a college town, so I happen to know quite a bit about landlord tenant law because it's all contract law.
Sure.
You see?
Yep.
So, you know, most people don't even read the contracts, but there's certain covenants that the landlord is supposed to, you know, use due care and caution. And there's certain things that tenants require to do. For instance, when you first move into an apartment, the landlord is required to give you a check-in list. And you go throughout the apartment or the house and you check off the things that are damaged, and you're supposed to provide that to the landlord. And then, you know, and then the landlord is required to provide you with the information as to where your security deposit is supposed to be located, what financial institution. And when you move out, at least in the state of Michigan, of a leasehold and a tenancy is up, there's a time period in which you are required to provide your forwarding address to the landlord in which to receive the security deposit back. But where landlords really get tenants on is, Craig, is the landlord doesn't present the list to the tenant. The tenant doesn't even know the law requires it. And then when the tenant moves out, you know, they don't get their security deposit back. They get a bill for $1,000, $2,000 in damage that was already there before they moved in. And then what's the recourse? I mean, most people don't know how to go up against a landlord. And I've seen a lot of sad cases out there. I truly have.
Well, you know, I'll tell you this much. A couple of times, you need to, I will say one thing. When you're filling out a lease for an apartment, because I've done this, you know, being a radio, I move around a lot. So I do a lot of this kind of stuff. And it's gotten to the point now where you have to make sure that your security deposit that you, I mean, it's kind of getting off the topic of where we were going for this, but your security deposit sometimes isn't a security deposit. Most of the time, a security deposit is a deposit against if you cause any damages in the apartment, then that deposit goes to fix the damages. So let's say the apartment is perfectly clean and fine. Your security deposit is $500. While you're in the course of living there, normal wear and tear is one thing. But let's say you put a hole in one of the walls. That $500 is going to go towards fixing that. Now, a landlord can patch that up for $20. A landlord can have a contractor come in with drywall and fix it for $300. It really just depends, you know, on the landlord, what they want to do. Sometimes that security deposit is also masqueraded as a cleaning deposit. In other words, you're already going to forfeit a couple hundred dollars of that that they're going to use to clean the apartment before the next tenant moves in. You don't get that back. That's just gone money.
Yeah.
You have to be careful and watch out for that stuff.
But in fairness to landlords, because I have a lot of friends that are pretty large landlords, especially in Mount Pleasant, Michigan. I mean, there's some great landlords here.
Right.
But I've seen some really bad landlords. But, you know, people do destroy property.
Yeah.
And look, that's somebody's investment. You have a lot of mom and pops, families that purchase a home, they flip them, or it's their retirement, and, you know, they don't have a savings, they don't have cash, they don't have a portfolio of stocks and bonds and other commodities.
But they have some real estate.
They have real estate.
Yep.
And being a landlord, it's a rough job.
I'm telling you.
Like I said, I have very close friends who are attorneys and non-attorneys, and I would not want that job, nor do I ever want to be a landlord. But there are a lot of landlords out there that do take advantage of tenants because, for the most part, you end up in small claims court, and it's very easy for a landlord to send you to collections, and now you can't even, you know, get an apartment or a house, and you don't know the recourse. But there are a lot of state agencies, especially in the state of Michigan, the state of Michigan folks, and all over the country, because this show is downloaded, Craig, in every state. Each state has a landlord-tenant handbook as to which the laws are. So be
the
sure.
Rights. Your
the
rights. Rights.
The rights of a tenant and the rights of landlords. It goes both ways. But before you sign a lease, speak to a landlord-tenant lawyer. I'm not one of them, although I don't. It's all contract law. But definitely get that handbook and read it, okay? Now, one of the things that landlords I've seen have done in this town is they're in these leases, they'll say, okay, look, if we find out that you have someone else living there that's not on the lease, that's not paying rent, we're going to charge you.
Yeah.
We're going to prorate it when we find out. But here's what these landlords do. They will literally send a custodian into your apartment as if they're doing a regular checkup on some maintenance to look around into these closets and bedrooms, especially in the summertime when students go home, to see if somebody else is living there. And if you have a boyfriend, a girlfriend, or even a sibling who is just up visiting for the weekend, I've seen landlords tack on thousands of dollars in fees that's contained in these lease agreements that's in small print, as if somebody else is living there. And then the tenant, they contact an attorney and say, I just got a notice from my landlord that I owe them $2,000 because they think somebody else is living here and my brother was visiting for 3 days. Or they have a cat that, you know, the parents came up, dropped off the cat, went to the grocery store. Somehow or another, the landlord catches wind of that. And then the lease, it says, if you have a cat, one, we're going to, or a pet without our permission, we're going to hit you with another $1,000. I have seen this 100 times, if not more, in college towns that landlords do this to students. And often, in fairness to landlords, you know, tenants do bring aboard pets that damage their investment without their permission. All you have to do is pay a pet fee. They do have other individuals stay there that are not on the lease and that they should be paying rent. So again, it goes both ways. But as a defense attorney, I happen to see it, you know, more that the landlords were abusing their position as a landlord and the tenant wasn't even sure what they signed to begin with. And now they're in court. Their credit is ruined. These are young people graduating from college or young couples trying to start a family. Now their credit is ruined. And it's a cycle there. But we got on landlord tenant law, Craig, because we were talking about people contacting my law office. I had two of them over the last 6 months asking me about landlord tenant law and can they smoke in a legal state where they have a right to do so? And, you know, what advice would I give? And my advice was, well, look, if you're in an apartment, you know, you might want to smoke your product in a vape pen or an edible, as you said, or a capsule, topicals. There's different ways to participate rather than just go out there and have a joint and a pipe or a blunt, whatever you want to call it, or a big bong. You know, there's different ways not to bring attention to yourself.
Yes. Before we get
back. That was all in one breath.
I know. That was amazing how you did that. Before we get back to that part of it, though, one other thing about tenant and landlord lease agreements, watch out for subletting, because that's another one. You know, you are in the apartment for 3 months, and then you said you're going to go move in with your boyfriend, so you want to sublet out your apartment, have somebody else take over the lease. Well, you don't get off the lease. Yeah, you don't do it, because if you don't get off the lease, not only are they going to charge you, they're going to think that you still live there, and they're going to charge that somebody else is living there, and you're going to get burned doubles. Don't do it.
Well, hold on, Craig. Wait, let's talk about subletting, okay, or signing a lease. First off, you cannot sublet the space, the tenancy, unless the contract specifically gives you permission to do so. And more often than not, in the contract, the landlord requires written permission from the landlord in order to sublet. Now, if you do have someone subletting, here's the thing. If they end up taking off, then the responsibility goes back to the tenant who originally signed the contract.
That's you.
Or the term of the lease. Now, I've seen cases where landlords have gone after tenants in court for damages because of vacating the lease before the tenant even vacates the leasehold. So somebody owes 1 or 2 months rent. I saw a landlord 1 year go after somebody for the remainder of the 8 months. And this is way back in the day when I wanted to help one student. I don't do this stuff. But I sent a letter to the landlord. I said, look, you can't ask for damages that haven't occurred yet. Okay, maybe you could get 2 months damage, but you want another 6 months. Those months haven't even come and gone yet. You can't ask for damages for something that hasn't happened yet. The law does not allow that, and they kick the case out of court. The tenant paid the 2 months they owe, finished out the tenancy.
That's good. So but this leads me to...
I got some more advice for you, Craig.
Oh, I'm sure you do.
Big advice. Most people don't even realize this, that if I spend 2 weeks on Craig Russell's couch, I'm considered a tenant, and you have to evict me through the court. Did you know that, Craig?
Didn't know that.
Yeah, I mean, it's about 2 weeks. In fact, you have to evict your own child. You always hear, you know, growing up, oh, my parents kicked me out of the house. I had to go stay with so-and-so. But what most people don't realize, you can't just kick your kid out of the house. You have to evict them. I mean, who knows that law, right? I know that
law. Yeah, and who's going to do it? Who's going to actually take their kids to court and evict them?
Yeah, most kids just grab the stick with the little bag on the end and head out on the highway. Put it over your shoulder cartoon growing up, right?
Yeah, I was going to say, what is this, a peanuts
game? Rascals.
No,
yeah, little rascals.
Come on, Craig, come on, Todd.
Have a blunt, sit back, and enjoy some white truffle, would you?
All right, we got to take a break on the Todd I Love It Law Show, but I do have one more law question to ask you when we come back in the final segment of the show, so hold tight.
This song is called Long Gone Day. Mr. Mark Lanigan.
I'm gone. Girl, I just want you to come on down. Lord, it's a storm in my head and I fall. These sins are mine and I've done wrong. Oh, baby, come on down. Come on down, my babe. I know it's been a long, long gone day.
Welcome back to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show, broadcasting and podcasting. And the Black Diamond Group Mothership, my throat is all scratchy. I on my way over here today, Craig, I actually rode my fat bike a couple miles.
Wow.
And I think it was like 5 degrees out, so my throat's a little rough this morning here, Craig.
A little chilly. Maybe you need some dank. Dankity dank, 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 dank,
dank, dank, dank, dank. How about a little cake mix and put that in the mix there?
Yeah, a little white truffle. There you go.
Hey, by the way, once again, I want to wish my cousin Anthony happy birthday. He turned 3 this Yay. Past week, you know, there. And happy birthday to my cousin Anthony, also known as AZ. And Anthony, his brother Jack, who is my godson. I just love my family. So big shout out to Anthony. Uncle Tuna loves you guys. And I'm going to see you soon. I have a lot of presents for those
Uncle
guys.
Uncle Tuna, you're funny.
Uncle Tuna.
Uncle Tuna. So Uncle Tuna, I had one other question about this whole landlord and a tenant thing, and it has to do with medical marijuana. So let's say you are a patient of a doctor, and the doctor prescribes that you need to use medical marijuana for your ailments, and that is a doctor prescription. I mean, this is not just I just want to smoke because I enjoy partaking. This is, you have to have this medicine. And you live in a government subsidy housing, you know, so let's say you get some rental credits or something like that. What happens if you try and smoke in a government subsidy house? Obviously, the government, you know, federal government, this is still Schedule I drug. This is still technically illegal, but you're in a state where medical marijuana is legal. How does that work out?
So it's a good question. And this issue actually came up at least a number of times in the state of Michigan, whereby individuals, I never followed up on it, but I'm going to have to look into this. It's been a couple of years already, probably about 5, 6, 7 years. Maybe more, maybe less. But you're right. I mean, the federal government, if there's federal subsidies and the funds are from the federal government and you live in a unit or units, even though you have a medical legal right to do so, there's a conflict there.
Big one.
Federal law always controls over state law. I did receive a couple calls in my office back in the Wild West days when all this was first coming about. I'm going to have to talk to Mike Camorn or Denise and find out where all that led, what happened with all that.
So yeah,
I think they would be in a
be
much better position than I would to answer those questions, but I did receive those calls, Craig. But I'm not even answering the question. I'm just kind of...
Yeah, I know, because...
See me getting around it? See the lawyer in me right there? Did you see that?
You've done a fine job.
I pushed it off on somebody else. Hey, I'm human, okay?
You've done a fine job, and now you can charge me $200 an hour for that. So that's...
Nah, for you, $125.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for that. I appreciate it.
Hey, by the way, we did not play Pantera this week, folks. Cowboys from Hell. We played Mark Lanigan, who passed away. Mark was from Screaming Trees.
Yes.
And the song we played at the show today was Mad Season, supergroup with Pearl Jam, Lane Staley from Alice in Chains fame, Love Lane, Alice in Chains, great group, and Mark Lanigan. So 57 years of age. Boy, that was tragic. I mean, Meatloaf, yeah. Mark Lanigan, so many other greats. Really sad.
We've already lost a lot of people this early on in 2022. This has got to stop. I don't recommend this dying thing anymore.
Yeah, there's a lot going on in the world. We're not talking about any of it. We just want to keep it light today and, you know, just provide you some entertainment, a little bit of information. But, you know, mostly we try to entertain and a little bit of information, Craig, right?
And mostly a little bit of dankity dank to dank to dank dank.
Dank and dank to dank to dank dank dank. You are America's favorite nug. And we did talk about some of the least stinky products versus the most stinky. If you happen to be a tenant in a leasehold in which you either have a right to participate in cannabis use or not. Check with your landlord and or read the fine print on your landlord-tenant agreement if you can grow and smoke. There's a lot of landlords who will allow you to grow. A lot of landlords will not allow you to grow in a state in which you have a legal right to do so. But you definitely, you know, you don't want to get evicted and leave all those beautiful plants behind and have them just torn out of, you know, whatever they're being grown in. I mean, I've heard some horror stories back in the day.
I would imagine if your landlord lets you grow, you probably need to share some with him or her.
And
they probably are going to want some.
If I was a landlord, that's the first thing I would say is, okay, hey, what strains do you have?
If you're growing, you're showing. You
know, if you're growing, you're showing and you're sharing.
There you go.
Growing, Todd, showing, and sharing. GSS right here on Craig Russell, the law show. Craig Russell's law show. Hey, by the way, big shout out to Big Daddy Danny Bain.
Oh, yeah.
And Judge Farrell, a great judge who is out of Gladwin, 80th District Court, and Claire Harrison. Judge Farrell is supposed to be coming on the show here the next month or two. And Judge Bain and Judge Hattie are coming back on the show. Look, we invite all the judges to come on the show. Why not, right, Craig?
Exactly. We should have a whole show with just judges. That'd be great.
I would love to.
That would be great.
I don't think we could talk about some of the things we talk about, but why not? We're exercising our First Amendment right.
That's right. Speaking of shows and wrapping things up, this show's over. We got to go.
Come on, Craig.
Come on, Todd.
Craig, I love you, buddy.
I love you too,
big
man.
Shout out to Biker Bob out there and my good buddy Todd Wakely. We haven't given him a big shout out. Little John.
Hey!
Hey, all our good friends that listen to the show. We're not here for a long time. Take us out with some Mark Lanigan, Mad Season. What are we here for, Craig?
We're here for a good time, Todd.
Take us out, Mando.
Lord, it's a storm in my head.
Todd L. Levitt Law Show, brought to you by Chad Malley Well Drilling of Rosebush. Clark Modular Homes, your most experienced and trusted builder in Mount Pleasant. Clear Vision Windows, Siding, and Roofing, now booking in Central and Northern Michigan. And attorney Todd L. Levitt, not just a litigator, he's an advocator.
Opinions expressed on this radio program do not necessarily reflect the views of this radio station.